Welcome back to another episode of TVGP's Critical Misses. Show where Moonpeer and I are catching up on all the meaty hits we missed. I'm your host, Boston. Joining me, as I mentioned, Moonpeer.
Hi.
As season 14, episode 4, we're back for Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol.
Mission Imposable?
Mission Imposable.
Is it like Action Man? Like those?
Yep. It's just...
That you got when you were a kid?
Yep, a kid plays with a Tom Cruise doll for 2 hours. It's riveting.
Uh-huh. They work for the Lego movie, I'm just saying.
Yeah, that's fair. You bring up a good point. So I think we've been talking kind of on and off all season about this being kind of the... From the outside looking in, this is the beginning of the family... fast saga-ness switch here of this series. I don't think either one of us have seen this, right?
I have seen this one. This is the last of the four that I have seen.
Okay. I'm fairly sure I didn't see this one. If I did, I don't remember anything about it. I feel like I remembered maybe one or two things about the last one. But I don't remember anything about this one at all.
Okay, let's ask our usual question when it comes to the Mission Impossible movies.
Okay.
Who directed this movie, Boston? Okay.
So this is one of the only things that I have seen about this movie. We've talked about this in the past. If one of us hasn't seen either of these things, we try and go in as blind as possible. I know Brad Bird directed this one, which is like the most wild thing. Like the dude who did the Iron Giant in Incredibles. I was gonna make a Mission Impossible movie. It's like, yeah, word. Okay.
And Ratatouille as well, by the way.
Yes. not to be forgotten, one of Pixar's secret best movies. Wild.
He also directed the music video for Do the Bartman.
Of course he did. Why wouldn't he have? Oh, jeez. So I think that's pretty interesting, because I feel like I don't think I've seen anything live action out of Brad Bird before. So I'm...
Dude, I think this is it.
Yeah, I'm one of one. So I'm kind of curious to see. I feel like maybe this will be telling for the second part of the episode. I feel like we're not really going to see much of that sort of Pixar animation stuff bleed into here. Obviously, it's not an animated movie, but I feel like that's kind of a different level of sensibility than these kind of popcorn action movies.
Right. I do think he sneaks in an A113, I believe.
Okay. There's one everywhere, so that's not surprising.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which I think is a Pixar thing.
Yeah. But I feel like when you look at Pixar movies, I'm not a fan of the Incredibles movies. But I think when you look at those, there is, especially those two movies, there's kind of an undercurrent of kind of like tiredness and sadness in those movies as much as they are superhero movies.
There's the undercurrent of being a grown-up in modern-day world. Yes.
Yeah, being a grown-up sucks, lol. So I feel like we're probably not going to see any of that sort of stuff in this movie. I feel like, especially following on the heels of the last one, which had some really good stuff in it, like we talked about last episode, I don't think we're going to see any undercurrents here. I think we're going to see a lot of currents of Tom Cruise running around and yelling about a cyber bomb or something,
That's a nice transition. What's the mission?
I feel like when you look at something like Ghost Protocol, I feel like you're combining like Ethan Hunt and his new crew going rogue from the IMF because of a cyber thing, a ghost b- bomb, a ghost in the machine virus, some sort of codes that are bad for the internet. Packets.
What happens when an agent gets caught behind enemy lines?
I have seen that sniper movie. That was a good one.
I hate you so much.
I know. That movie's really good. Yeah. I that's kind of the thing that I like about these movies is, you know, if you compare them to something like the Fast Saga, it's like, all right, what MacGuffin is going to make them drive real fast in these ones? And I feel like...
With, drive real fast or run real fast?
Well, this one is, what is he going to run real fast after? You know, a precision running team. This is all just him training for a marathon.
Tom Cruise and Usain Bolt.
Yeah, Tom Cruise and Simon Pegg running a 5K. But I feel like that's something that I kind of like about these movies, especially with each one having a different director so far, is it's kind of like, obviously Tom Cruise is going to run. A whole bunch of hacking and shooting is going to happen, but I feel like it's a little bit less maybe predictable on its face than some of the other kind of popcorn action movies are. And I kind of dig that because I don't know what we're really getting into. I'm assuming, I think it's Tom Cruise is obviously back. I'm assuming Simon Pegg is back. My concern is that Ving Rhames is not back because Simon Pegg is kind of stepping into that role.
Into the hacker role.
Yeah.
Oh, that's an interesting.
I hope that's not the case. But I feel like none of these teams can have two nerds on it. So.
Well, I mean, the Fast and the Furious movies have two or three nerds sometimes.
Yeah, but the Fast and Furious movies have like, it's like Arcade Fire up on the stage. There's 18 people in those movies at any time driving in like 17 cars. So it's like, yeah, you can have five nerds if you want.
Zero doesn't make an appearance. Now that I've actually seen what that thing looks like.
That's right. Oh boy. I don't know. I don't think this is the one with our British crush. I think that's the next one.
I believe you are correct. I'm pretty sure the next one is the one that has
our mustachioed, our mustachioed Henry Cavill crush. So that's a negative in the column for this one, to be sure. Other than that, I don't really know who is in this one. I'm gonna assume Vin Diesel doesn't show up, as much as I think that would be really great. He's their getaway driver.
The best part of that would be if at the end of the last movie, it ends with a phone call from Vin Diesel being like, your next mission, if you choose to accept it, is to aid the family.
That's right. You're part of the family now. That
would be hilarious.
Yeah, that would be really good. Other than that, I don't know. I feel like this is in 2011, so we're getting a lot more modern here. Kind of just excited to watch another Tom Cruise Mission Impossible action movie. I so far they've been really good. The last one was really good.
Sure, 3 is amazing.
Yeah, and it seems like with this becoming more and more of a franchise, I'm assuming there's even an even bigger budget, an even dumber stunt that actual Tom Cruise is actually doing.
Yep, I can confirm that the Tom Cruise stunt in this movie is a crazy one.
Okay. Tom Cruise learned how to do something nuts again. Whoa. I feel like this is not the one where he's hanging out of the side of an airplane as it takes off. That might be the next one, too.
Don't even think that's the next one. I think that's Fallout, which is the final one.
Okay. Yeah, it'll be the final one for us. I just remember like the GIFs and clips on Twitter of like, well, here's what it looks like on film. And I was like, wow, that's crazy. And they're like, here's the camera we put on the plane for Tom Cruise. And it's like, that's the same thing. Oh, no. Tom Cruise, what are you doing? So I'm curious to see what crazy thing he's gonna do in this one.
Yeah, it's definitely crazy. I'll tell you that right now.
Yeah.
It involves a location we have seen in one of our previous seasons.
Well, ooh, okay. All right. So we're bringing it back full circle to a previous season. Exciting. Uh-huh.
And when you find out what season it is, you're going to laugh your head off.
Okay. Now I'm excited. What are your kind of overall remembrances about this movie?
I remember liking this a lot. I think there is a new cast member in this who didn't click with me at the time. Like, I think they are fine, but I don't think they are, like, they don't stand out in the same way that, like, Ving Rhames stood out in the first one, or Simon Pegg. He had 30 seconds of screen time in the last movie, and he's one of the most memorable parts of that movie. In a movie that has Philip Seymour Hoffman stealing every scene he's in.
Yeah, yeah, like, Simon Pegg is bookending 30 seconds of that movie, and it's like, he was great. It's like, well, yeah, I mean, you're not wrong, but...
This additional character didn't click well with me, just on the story itself. And I don't know if they come back for future iterations or not. I know there is another female agent in this movie. I don't think it's a female agent we've seen before. Which, again, kills me a little bit, because it's like, come on, just please. Just have one solid female character throughout the series.
Right. As the series hates women less, can we have more women in them, please?
Yes. Ideally, consecutively showing up time after time after time. That would be really nice.
I mean, in the last movie, they didn't even bring up Thanity Newton or anything. It's like, who? What? He's the... Nope. Never mind. Never happened. Uh-huh. Wink.
But
it's
also, like, Tom Cruise was married.
Mm-hmm.
Or Ethan Hunt was married, I should say.
That's right. Tom Cruise was also famously married, but that's a whole different show.
Yeah. I don't want to talk about bouncing couches today.
No. Yeah.
Because I think it was around about the same time as well, just to make things more fun.
Yeah.
I don't know, to be honest. Like, is that... I kind of remember the MacGuffin in this movie, but not 100%.
Mm-hmm.
It will be... Hold on, what year did this come out?
2011.
It will be weirdly appropriate again for the Mission Impossible movies to be 10 years ahead of their schedule.
Nostradamus writing these movies.
Huh?
Yep.
Real world Mission Impossible movies 10 years later. Kind of thing. Which...
Oh, that's terrifying.
Consider we're recording this in June of 2022, that should give you an idea of what things stand like right now.
Great. Good. Tom Cruise. I forgot to mention it. I'm not sure what the level of how big Tom Cruise's fingerprints are going to be on this movie. I think we talked in last episode about Tom Cruise stepping into more of an executive producer role. And as we've seen in some movies, sometimes it's like, yeah, but you're executive producer. Whatever. Don't worry about it. And other times you see it be like, well, this is like my series. I'm gonna put my stamp on it. I wonder if we'll...
Did he Vin Diesel the franchise is what you're trying to find out.
Yeah. And I was talking to my wife about that a couple weeks ago as we were... in the car going to the zoo, trying to compare the Fast Saga movies, where Vin Diesel very clearly has a heavy influence over that series, for good or bad. You could argue both. But it's been kind of interesting to see, as these movies and as Tom Cruise's popularity rises over the now decades since we have started this film franchise, how much of his influence sort of settles in on these films. And I don't think we've seen anything super heavy-handed, but I think we're starting to see kind of more influences here and there.
Yeah, and it's not like he's made himself into a superhero yet either. Like,
Right.
the last movie was him on the ragged edge the entire time. Like, he was
Well,
desperate from like the second minute of that movie onwards.
and that's what I was drawing parallels between too, because you can see the Fast Saga movies sort of getting trapped and kind of painting themselves into the corner of, all right, my contract says I only get hit three times, I can only fall down once, I can't have a bloody lip, no black eyes, that's for sure. And then this one is
Oh,
like, all
can't
right,
lose the fight. It
right.
can, or if I lose one, then I have to win one. It has to,
Right.
it's WWE booking where it's 50-50 the whole way down.
And in Mission Impossible 3, Tom Cruise is like, what if I get tortured in like the first 2 minutes and then they're gonna shoot me and probably kill me. And then the credits. It's like, what?
And what if my wife is the hero?
Right. Yeah, what if I like die for a little bit at the end of the movie? Does that sound okay? It's like, sure. I guess. Do you come back to life? I have questions. But yeah, I'm curious to see where the if that sort of stuff continues, or if it gets as heavy-handed as the Fast Saga does, as we kind of progress through these next couple of movies. It's a real bummer too that the final two movies aren't coming out until like the end of 2023, I think. So we won't be able to finish the fight with the last two-parter here. But yeah. All right, anything else for this one? I think that's
No,
it.
I'm honestly looking forward to it.
Yeah.
Because it's been a long time since I've seen this one. I've
Yeah.
gone back to two, I've gone back to three, two for its sublime cheesiness, and
It's
three for it
craziness.
just being a genuinely fantastic movie.
Yeah.
This one I'm curious to see how it holds up. Oh crap, I just remembered a great scene. Okay.
Okay.
It involves a sheet. That's all I'll say. That's
Great.
all I'll say.
Love it. All right, let's go watch the movie. We're back. We've traveled across the globe to watch this film. My first note here is a Tom Cruise production, immediately answering our question, I wonder how much influence Tom Cruise has on this movie. It's not even like it's what's so funny is I feel like so many people would have come up with like a clever
A name.
production house, like, oh, it's Cruise Control Productions, wink. And it's just like, no, this is a
Like
Tom Cruise production.
JJ's got his bad robot and
Right.
everybody's got their other stuff. But no.
You know who
No.
I am? I'm Tom Cruise.
And if you didn't know who I am, then you really, really should.
That's right. I'm Tom Cruise, the volleyball player. You know me. I kind of like that it opens with a bit of a sizzle reel too. I feel like we don't see that often in movies. We got a little highlight of all the action that's coming up in the rest of the film.
Are we gonna completely skip over the prison break scene?
I'm working to it, but
Because
we gotta
that
talk
happens
about.
after the prison break scene.
Okay, go ahead.
I just like the prison break scene.
Yeah.
It's hilarious. And look who's back. Back again. Benji's back. All
Yeah,
right.
Benji now in the field. To be fair, it does open with the IMF agent getting killed by that lady from God, what is it? Death
Yes.
Stranding.
Yes.
Yeah,
Wait, what?
Leia Sado from Death Stranding.
Wait, is she the rain lady?
I think so. Where is she here in this? Let me look at what her role is here in Death Stranding. Fragile, yes. She
Yep,
was
she's the rain lady.
the one with the umbrella. So I think this is the only thing I have seen her in. other than being in Death Stranding. So
okay, so I've seen her in a different movie. Maybe two, I think. We'll get to that when we get to our Bond seasons.
Oh, okay. Maybe I have seen her in more than one thing. Okay. She's totally an assassin, kills a dude, nuclear launch codes from the Russians.
Yep, I told you, 20 years, 20 years ahead of the time, again.
Still just predicting the future.
I do like Sawyer from Lost, though, doing the jump off the building with the thing, the inflatable cushion thing.
Yeah, like the inflatable backpack thing. I thought that was pretty.
Yes,
that was pretty cool.
Which I just like. He will always be Sawyer from Lost to me. By the way, he's never going to be anything but that.
That's followed by the Moscow prison breakout. The current IMF crew breaks out a mysterious person who just turns out to be Ethan Hunt. Ethan also takes out a fellow prisoner named Bogdan, who
seems like an idiot.
Seems like a big old dummy, but is Ethan's friend on the inside. That whole scene was fairly good. I like you get a lot more Benji in this movie, and I don't think he overstayed his welcome. Which is pretty impressive out of that character.
Do we want to deal with the Luther in the room first before we go too much further?
Yeah, I mean, I still miss Luther. We do get a little bit here at the end, but I don't know. I feel like Luther, both of the hackers kind of fill different roles. Where Luther was kind of like, yeah, I got this. Like, I'm cool. I'm sort of a little bit over Ethan's business here. And he's been in the field for a long time. And I kind of like that Benji is not like a fanboy of Ethan, but he's clearly a fan and is super jazzed to be in the field and is still very green. But still knows how to do the hacking side of stuff. So,
He knows how to do his job. He's just a little bit of a goofball sometimes.
Yeah, and I think Simon Pegg plays it really well. I think that's a really easy role to mess up, and I feel like he treads that line pretty well.
I think that's the funny thing about Pegg is he seems to be able to nail the roles that are easy for other people to mess up. He seems to pull them off so casually. Mm-hmm. Like, Scotty in Star Trek is not an easy set of shoes to fill.
That's true.
And I think he blew that one out of the water as well. Mm. And all of the Cornetto trilogy, you are connected with him on a quite significant level, which is interesting considering, you know, the dude was originally just a writer. Like, he just liked to write the stuff.
Yeah,
just happened to get a break or two.
Yeah, you're right. He always seems to get the role in a way that I think not a lot of people potentially could. So they extract Ethan. They find out what happened to IMF agent Trevor Hanaway, the dude who gets shot in the intro. And
Sawyer from Lost.
Right. Sawyer Hanaway.
Yes. He got all of the other IMF agents to paint his fence for him.
That's right.
I've never read that book, by the way.
Yeah. They figure out the new role here is the assassin that killed the IMF agent was trying to get the launch codes to a man they only know as Cobalt. So IMF says, here's a great idea. Let's get more information on Cobalt from the Kremlin. Just get on in there.
20 years early. Good on you. Mission Impossible for predicting the future. I honestly think that me and you together, we need to pay attention to the next couple of movies that we watch to see what's heading in our future. I'm
That's
just saying.
right. That's right. That's right. So I kind of like this whole mission here. I
It's
feel
so
like
good.
a
It's
lot of people
so
might
good.
yada yada their way through this, but I really like Tom Cruise's fake mustache in this outfit. It is between that and like his level of disdain for everybody around him when he's in character, and Benji not shutting up the entire time about how he needs to shut up and how much of a fan he is. Both
I
of
like
those
it
are
that when he tells him to shut up, he tells him to shut up in Russian, and he says sorry in Russian back because he
That's right.
keeps speaking in English.
That's right. It's so good. I really like the hallway thing here with this like giant video screen with a camera facing the other way. Like,
It's so good.
it's really good, and it's a really good piece of the thing that I like the Mission Impossible movies have done is, and we've sort of talked about this as we've gone through all of them, is the kind of like a little bit forward-looking but plausible technology here. Like you can see, like, yeah, it's like a foldable screen. Yeah, sure. It's got a camera. Yeah, okay. It's tracking where the guy's looking, so the hallway looks right. All right, yeah, okay.
Yeah, and quick sound design note here. I love that this entire sequence is silent. There's no score, there's no music, there's no nothing. The only sound really is.
It's the really like I really like the like high tech low tech that we've got going on here with the super high tech video foldable screen thing and then this little thing that goes bloop bloop like you got
Yep.
the
Like a
combo of the
drip
two.
noise projector.
Yeah, it's really good. And there's that really great shot of when Benji puts his face in front of the camera and it blows up really big on front of the like
Yeah.
that's really
It's
it,
so good, this entire sequence.
we actually haven't really talked about it yet, but I was really surprised at how funny this movie is, sort of way more than the other ones. The other ones have sort of been like Ethan gives somebody a stern look and you're like, yeah, he's in trouble. But this one the
Yes.
whole time, and not even it's not even just Benji's character that is the
No, it's
comedic relief. Yeah,
everybody in
everybody
this.
gets a little bit here, and even Tom Cruise gets a little
Well,
bit of comedy
his
here.
my favorite line of his is coming up shortly, I believe. But we'll get to that when we get to
Yeah,
it.
it is probably the
We
same line that I love, the one where he swears. It's like, yeah, that
Yes.
was good. Yep.
We should also give Paula Patton some credit here because we haven't talked about her yet.
Yeah, she's great.
She is so good. It's a shame to again see a different female agent.
Yeah.
It's like, where's the consistency for the ladies? Like, come on.
Yeah.
And could you imagine if it was Thandie Newton in the last movie and then,
Oh,
the
man.
same lady agent in this movie?
If only.
But yes, Paula Patton does a good job, and I'm glad they do more with her later in the movie.
Yeah, she gets to actually be an agent and do agent things. I
She
like
is
that.
more than just a honeypot, although she is a
Right.
honeypot at some point.
Right.
Which we'll get to that when we get there.
Yeah. The mission goes okay. Ethan figures out that the little microfilm or microfiche, I never remember the difference. The little
I
canisters are.
think it's film when it's in the roll, it's fish when it's in the slide.
Gotcha. So he finds out they're empty, and that's when another team accidentally starts broadcasting over the frequency, which is a really good moment. And Tom Cruise very quickly says abort, and everybody starts scattering because they're like, "Yeah, you know, we got what we wanted to, so let's just blow up the Kremlin." It's like, "What? Gotta go." That's not even hesitate. And they all escape. I really. There's a really great scene here where Tom Cruise is escaping in his Russian outfit and yells at the guards to close the gate because they left it open, goes out the side door and changes into his, like,
his coat.
Yeah, his like American tourist outfit, which is really, really good.
It's so basic. Like, it's super duper basic, but it's so good the way it happens.
Yep. He just flips the coat around. That's good.
And of course he's got a Bruce Springsteen t-shirt on.
That's so good. That's great.
Uh-huh.
Oh man. And then the Kremlin blows up. The Kremlin and nearly everything around it all the way blows up. There are a lot of explosions. Which segues into a shot I actually really, really like in this.
This is one of my favorite shots of this entire movie.
Yeah, where he's waking up and the subtitles are in Russian, and as he gains consciousness, they fade into English, which is a real good little piece. Because I was watching and I was like, I'm not sure I understand what's... Oh, okay. They changed. Great. That's good.
It's like, are the subtitles meant to be in Russian?
Yeah.
Like, is this what...
It's really good. Everybody else escapes except for Hunt. Hunt is tied up, semi-arrested in the hospital.
Because, of course, he was collared by his reversible jacket.
Yes. Yep. There's an agent there that is gonna bring him in, is charging him for destroying the Kremlin. What follows is one of the funniest scenes in this movie, I think, of Tom Cruise on the the side of the building, second guessing his escape plan.
The guy's just like, go ahead.
I like that the guy's just like, all right, let's see what happens, man. Like, most movies, he'd already be shooting him, but it's just like, yeah, look, do you think this is going to go well?
Especially considering it's a hospital dumpster, and you know those blue bags are full of medical waste.
Yep. I really like that there's a one moment here from Ethan of just like, I thought this would turn out well, and I took a second to think about it, and I don't think this is going to go well for me. Of course, he escapes anyway, which using his belt to escape.
I do like the sassy nurse, though, when the guy puts a cigarette in his mouth in the hospital.
She yoinks it immediately.
She's like, this is a hospital, not a nightclub.
Mm-hmm. That feels a very true to life kind of thing that... A nurse has had to say more than once, which is distressing. So Hunt escapes. He's kind of on the run. He meets with the IMF secretary and his intelligence analyst, William Brandt.
I'm curious if it's the IMF secretary or the Secretary of Defense, because they never actually say his full job title.
When I was looking stuff up, everywhere refers to him as the IMF secretary, but that kind of doesn't seem right.
It doesn't make sense, because why would he be going to accept something from Russia if he's not someone huge in the government like the Secretary of Defense?
Yeah.
He would logically have control over IMF.
Right, and he's turning in his resignation because of the explosion. Like, that's not a secret position, sort of, so. But it's nice to see Tom Wilkinson in that role. He is always good in everything. Even though he lasts maybe 3 minutes. But he tells Ethan that the president has initiated ghost protocol.
Did you mention that we got introduced to the chief analyst,
Mr. Brandt? Yes, William Brandt, Billy B, which played by Jeremy Renner.
Jeremy Renner.
Right. It's probably the only role I have seen Jeremy Renner in that I have enjoyed, which is odd. I don't hate him. It's just he's like the white bread of film roles. It's sort of like, yeah, he was fine. I'm not gonna remember him in probably 30 minutes, but he was all right.
Yeah, that's true.
He gets a little bit of room to roam in this movie, and I think that does him a lot of good. So Ghost Protocol is IMF as a whole has been disavowed, which turns into the secretary not telling Ethan how to go pursue Cobalt.
Don't escape between
Right.
here and the
Yeah.
airport. Don't
Don't hop
find
on
this
this
train.
super armed secret train.
And don't investigate this without our knowledge.
Yeah.
Wink, wink,
Wink.
nudge,
Oops, I got
nudge.
shot in the head.
So, hold on. You need to call this out because this is a
Yeah.
nice little twist that they actually don't make reference to. He pulls out the USB stick from his sachet of USB sticks, which,
His
of course.
bandolier of USB sticks.
And gives it to Ethan, and he says, "Your mission, if you choose to accept it."
Right.
And then Ethan grabs it off him, and then he's about to say, "Yeah, you've always been a friend. I deeply respect you, and all that kind of crap." The secretary is killed exactly 5 seconds after he gives the USB stick to Ethan.
Great.
Your mission will self-destruct in 5 seconds.
Two thumbs up. Love it. No
That's
notes.
a real nice little touch.
Yeah, so the driver and the secretary get killed. Hunt and Brandt get in the car, get tossed off this bridge and escape because they use a distracting flare. This turns into Brandt pestering Ethan about like, why did you know they were going to do that? How did you know? And Ethan's like, oh my God, we were getting shot at. I didn't. What was I going to do? I tried something. Shut up,
I
Jeremy
played a
Renner.
hunch, which is a good
That's
line.
right. I like this scene of them finding the train and hopping on it while avoiding
The posts.
the posts and like him putting in the code and then it having him come back to hit enter and then having to come back and do
And do the
the
retinal scan.
scan. Like that's
Which I like the fact that he's jumping up and down next to it, trying to get it to go up
It's
first.
just
It's
like
just
a
like,
little too
really?
short. Like so it's really good. So the whole team is there in the future train, the cyber train. They
Can I just
watch.
say, I want one of these trains with
It's
the
very
drop
cool.
down tablet, like from the wall where he just pulls
Yeah.
it from the wall and it's a table. It's like,
It's really good.
Yes, please.
So they watch the video of Kurt Hendricks, which is a Russian nuclear strategist who wants to start a nuclear war between the US and Russia because he thinks that will make everybody stronger if the weak
Yes.
die because of nuclear war, well then just the strongest have to survive, right? It's fine. It's flawless. It'll work.
Yeah. Trimmed down, its extinction events are part of nature.
Yeah.
Life goes on.
It's all
Everyone
death.
gets
It's Death
better.
Stranding again, man.
Everyone gets better after the fact.
Yeah, it's nuclear war. They'll be fine.
So maybe humans and nuclear war has a place in the next natural disaster kind of thing, as
Yeah.
long as it's fair to everyone.
That's right. Everybody needs to get nuked, not just a couple of people. It's actually it's a well-crafted sort of thing that I think that it's not an impassioned speech, which I think is kind of the reason why I think it works for me is sort of like
It's
academically.
also, yeah, it's also helpful that he literally says, "Yeah, I predicted the worst outcomes of humans for 20 years, and I got numb." And it's like, yeah, okay, I could see where someone who's numb to all of that can go down this rabbit hole. Like, that
Right.
makes perfect sense.
Yeah, it's pretty well done.
Did you recognize Michael Nyquist, Hendrix, as he's known?
Yeah, it's one of those. He's got one of those faces where I'm like, I've seen you in a bunch of stuff. I don't know if I could say 100% like, oh, I've seen you in X, Y, and Z. But
Do you want me to
he's
tell you what you've seen him in Critical
sure.
Misses?
Oh, yeah, okay.
He is the father of the kid than John Wick. He's the hype man for John Wick, who gives the speech.
Right. Okay. Yep. He's great. I two thumbs up.
With a pencil, Boston.
That's right. That's right. Man, he's good. So they figured out that Hendrix used the Kremlin bombing to cover up the theft of the Russian launch control device, which he is planning to trade with a guy named Moreau in Dubai to get the launch codes. Sorry, he's planning a trade. He's not going to give
Yes,
him
he's
the
going to
launch
trade
control device.
diamonds with Moreau, and Moreau
Right.
is the hitman lady from the intro sequence.
Right. He's going to get the codes from her and he'll have the launch device and then he should be
And the
good.
codes, and
Yeah.
then we're good to go.
He's good. Yeah, he's all ready. So there's also a scene that happened, I think, before this where Hendrix goes to kidnap the cryptographer, the Russian guy that's like, "Hey, the Kremlin blew up. We got to get out of town. Pack the bags. We got to go right now." And then there's that really good shot of him looking back at the dinner table, and Hendrix is just
Oh.
sitting there. That's a real nice little shot.
Yeah, I think that's before this, I
It's
believe.
like
It's
either
def.
before that or like right here. I don't remember. So they go to Dubai,
Yeah.
and their plan is to use the tools they have available now that the IMF is disavowed are few. So they're going to fake not one but two meetings at the same time to try and get both the codes and authenticate them and give them to the dude to track him down to get to Hendrix. There's like,
Yeah, and give him fake code specifically at first.
right, yeah. There's sort of a lot going on in, like, for the rest of this movie, there's a whole lot going on all the time.
What's the big set piece? What's the location that they're doing this at?
The tallest tower in the world. No big deal. Yeah.
Like, of course, we're at the Burj Khalifa
Yeah.
because why not?
Yeah, Hitman 3's best level. I mean, it's one of my favorite lines in this scene is when Benji is telling Ethan, like, "Hey, you gotta get to the server room. Here's all the reasons why you can't get in the room from inside. You have to, get into the room from the outside of the building." And Ethan is like, "Okay, fine. What level is it on?" He goes, "130." It's just like, Ethan's just like, "Oh, 130. Sure. Why not?"
I also like the fact that he's trying to get somebody else to do it, where he's like, he, like you said, he explains all of the reasons he can't do it from inside. He's like, we need to get into it from the outside.
Right.
And Ethan's like, we? And he's like, well, I'm on the computer. I need to be here for the computer. And then Ethan looks over at Brent, and Brent's like, I'm the helper.
That's right. He was pretty salty about it about 15 minutes ago, and now he's like, "No, I'm not. Nope, that's not me. I'm the helper."
So that's when we get the gloves, the sticky gloves.
Yeah, man, this is a really good scene.
And this is the stunt that Ethan, that Tom Cruise performed again.
Of
For
course he did.
real, by the way.
Why wouldn't he? Were they there on site at the real building?
They were.
Of course they were. Why not? Toss me on the 125th floor. I got some climbing to do. Man, this is a really, it's a really good scene. I also really like that shot when they remove the window from their hotel room and they
And it
see
pans over and down.
that and when they see the sandstorm coming from miles and miles away, that shot of just like, what is that? I like someone else is like, yeah, what is that? And it's like, guys, it's a sandstorm. Where do you think you are, dude? Like an area famous for its sandstorms. But of course,
Biddy
Benji
biddy
utters
boo.
the famous final words of like, it's ways off. We don't have to worry about that for a while. It's like, sure. Yep.
Yeah. I will admit, this is something that you may or may not have noticed, but through the whole movie, Brad Bird, the director, who, by the way, we need to talk about him before the end of this. He said he wanted to have every piece of technology, essentially, that Ethan Hunt interacts with, something goes wrong with it.
That worked.
Uh-huh. Because every piece of tech that he gets involved with breaks at some point. Like, minor future spoiler alert, but the mask-making machine that they have in the hotel,
yep, just Ethan sputters and
opens
dies.
Opens it and sets it up, and then it breaks.
Yep.
Benji gives him the gloves, which has the rolling motion to deactivate the stick in it. And these lights here, so just remember, blue is glue.
Yep.
What's red? Red is dead.
Yeah, I like how he just throws away, like, red is dead. Anyways, it's just like, yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. I do really like when the one breaks that Ethan's first response is just throw it away, and it flutters off and, like, glues itself back to the building. Off.
Above him, so he climbs up and sees it.
Yeah, it's really good. It's just a really solid, great, tense scene of him getting all the way up there, him cutting into the window, and the whatever they're using to cut, of course, breaks in the same way that it broke for Brandt and Benji as they were cutting out. It sparks and kind of spits at him a little bit, which of course leads him to plummet down this building in like a heart-dropping fashion.
That grab with the one arm as well is just like,
it always gets me when in movies like this, there's always that like squeaking, like skin on glass sound where I'm like, oh, that was close.
He climbs. Do you like how he gets in though? Like he climbs up and he does the pivot knees.
It's a really nice. So stressful. Yeah, just really, and I feel like it's kind of a nice small callback to Mission Impossible 2's intro of just like, yeah, of course he knows how to get up here. He's just climbing up like the Grand Canyon a couple movies ago. He's fine. He knows how to do this. He's been doing it for like 20 years. But yeah, he gets in there, do the hacking business. Benji's in business on his computer. They're like switching.
Do you like the fact that the one glove fails as well? Like as soon as he's through the glass?
Yep.
The glove just like sparks out and it's like, okay.
Yeah.
Sure.
Ethan jumps out of the window with some sort of spool of something.
Fire hose.
Yeah.
It looks like a fire hose spool. It's just
I was sort of expecting them to use like a spool of Cat 5 cable because that's always in every server room across the planet. I really... It's really great when Brandt is like, hey, the thing's too short. And Tom Cruise says, no crap.
Except he swears, which is a really good moment. Because he literally is yelling it across like a gap of like four or five windows.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just like,
yep. Well, and Brandt has been pestering him and badgering him about like 22 minutes 22
minutes to door knock.
Until door knock. And
21 minutes until door knock. The countdown is really not helping.
I also really like that Ethan's first thing is just like, fine, I'm just going to swing myself around the side of the tallest building in the world, and then I will just yeet myself into this window. Everything will go fine. And he just hits his forehead on the top of the window. Like,
He bodies the top frame of that, and it's so...
And just, like, tumbles down this building. It's so good. He hits his head a lot in this movie, and I really like it, because every mission goes wrong in this movie, and I really appreciate it.
It's a good catch by Brandt and Jane, though, right, doing the human ladder to keep him alive.
Yep.
Which, I like the fact that this whole time Benji's in the hallway, like, basically re-engraving the door numbers.
Yep.
And then he comes back in and is like, poof, that was a
tough job, but I did it. He's so proud of himself, little buddy.
What did I miss?
Yeah.
Everybody's just on the floor, like.
Yeah. I think this is the part where Brant and Ethan have the discussion about, look, we can't give Winstrom the fake codes because the cryptographer will figure out that they're not real if we give him the fake ones. So,
And the funny thing is, that cryptographer in question would probably verify even bad codes.
right, just to say, like, oh, they look totally great. Please fear my family. Thank you.
But they don't know that is the
Right.
best thing. It's like he is essentially an innocent man who would
Right.
probably verify it them if they were wrong, but they don't know it.
Yeah. So their plan is to give Winstrom the real codes on radioactive paper so that they can track the paper to wherever cobalt is. And
It tells you how long Ethan's been in prison though, because he's like, "Oh, we're using the paper clip," and he's like, "No, we're using the paper. Come on."
right. That's true. That is a good thing where it's like, come on, you old dinosaur. So Brant eventually says, like, yeah, that's fine. That's the best plan we have. Let's put on the masks. Let's go, break these meetings. Whoops. The mask machine rips. And I like that their just knee jerk is, well, I hope they've never met, so let's just go down and bust up these two meetings. And they also have a little, like, camera scanny thing in Brant's, the like,
The contact lens,
the contact lens.
which he blinks twice to
Yeah.
make a photocopy of the images that he's looking at and
Yeah,
then
and then they're
prints
like,
it into the briefcase.
OCR scanning and printing into the other briefcase. Like, it's real good. They bust in on both of those meetings. Nobody has met each other, which is the kind of saving grace. Benji has a third arm in his fake outfit.
When
And
you see when you saw him blow up that arm, did were you like, why the hell does he have a
yeah, I
blow
was
up
just
arm?
like, why is what are they doing? What are you doing, Benji? I really do like this sleight of hand that Benji's doing to, Moreau has authenticated that these the diamonds are real, and they're passing them between the two meetings because where are they going to get diamonds otherwise? Ne nevertheless, real diamonds. So they successfully scan the documents. There's a little bit of also sleight of hand about opening up the briefcase, and the code is 000, which is
This is a nice little touch.
yeah. They authenticate the documents, they get the hell out of there, the document meeting gets out of there. Moreau very quickly figures out, hey, something
She
seems.
sees the squares
Yeah, she's
in
like
the contact
watching
lens.
Brant the whole time of like, why is this weirdo, like, his eyes twitching and he's blinking a whole bunch. So she decides to attack them, of course. Moreau escapes, and Agent Carter, Paula Patton, chases her down. They have a bunch of really great fight scenes, which how do they get back? Oh, she brings
She
Moreau
brings
back to
Moreau
the
back to the
room.
hotel room.
Yeah, because I was like, man, how does she get kicked out of the window? Right. Paula Patton brings her back to the room.
And then Benji stops paying attention to an assassin
Right. He's
for
very
a
green.
split second.
That's right. And she gets kicked out of a window for maybe revenge, maybe self-defense. Well, maybe a little
Maybe
bit of both.
why not both?
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Ethan is chasing the, I can't remember his
Winstrom.
name. Winston,
Yeah.
thank you.
Yeah, Winstrom starts leaving. He kills the cryptographer, and Ethan's like, all right, well, we gotta go get him because this whole thing is going south. As Winstrom is leaving the building, the Russian agent stops him and gets his nose bashed in. And Ethan chases Winstrom through a sandstorm, which is a really cool scene.
There's the Tom Cruise running scene. I told you this was going to be a good one. I said you would like the running in this movie because of where it takes place.
I really do. And when the sandstorm is coming in, where I thought that was going to go was they were going to have to deal with the sandstorm coming in the various hotel rooms. But I didn't realize it would turn into a foot and then car chase through a sandstorm, which turned out to be really, really good and turns out to be
I like the glasses as well, by the way.
Like, yeah, where he pulls out the goggles after he still had them on his neck when he went to go meet with Moreau. So he still has the goggles, which is nice. This actually turns out to be our first mask rip of the movie as well. Our only mask rip. Thankfully, it's not the last reference. I kind of like that this turned out to be our mask rip of, no, it's not.
It's not Winstrom, it's Hendrix.
Yeah, it's not Winstrom, it's Hendrix. And I was like, oh, that's really good, actually. And Hendrix just hops on a truck and leaves.
That is an absolutely chaotic scene through the sandstorm, though. Like,
it's really good.
I've never been in a sandstorm like that. I probably never will be, but that does give me some sense of, yeah, this is probably real bad.
Yeah, this is as bad as people say it is. So they all go back to the kind of safe house. Everybody's fighting with each other because, of course, Ethan goes to leave to get a new lead and goes to meet with the Fog, who's somehow a friend of Bogdan.
We should probably mention at this point, he also tries to figure out how an agent with those skills became an analyst.
Oh yeah, because he it's really funny when he comes out of the bathroom, he's like washing his face and talking on the phone. Everybody's fighting, and I thought he was going to come out and like sort of push the peace on everybody and be like, all right, everybody stops fighting. He just turns on Brandon. He goes, you. And it's like, whoa.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or just an analyst.
That's right.
Because the pair of them beat the crap out of the security guards for Moreau. And
right.
Brandt was doing stuff that no analyst would do.
Right. And like disassembles Ethan's gun after Ethan points it at him. Like there's some cool stuff going on there. Brandt,
we've all got secrets.
Yeah, Brandt's essentially like, no. It's like, okay, cool. That's fine. No big deal.
And did you catch the Mission Impossible 1 reference with him going to meet the arms dealer?
I don't think so.
So he gets the mask over his face, which is the same mask from Mission Impossible 1. With the black balaclava with the red eyes.
Okay.
And it's the same guy putting the mask on him.
Yeah, because there was like, I was trying to figure out why he was, I read it as, all right, like, just put the mask on me again. I'm used to this whole thing. Like, let's keep going. But I didn't realize it was the same guy of like, yeah, you again. How's it going? How's the kids?
Yeah.
You know, like.
It's same guy, same mask.
That's great.
This was supposed to be Max.
Interesting. Okay.
They couldn't come to terms with Vanessa Redgrave, I think it is.
Right. That would have been
so
real good.
So she never came back for it.
Yeah, that would have been real good to have her back. The Fog decides to not help him by not telling him about a satellite that he has sold to a guy in
an Indian media mogul.
Yes, an Indian media mogul in Mumbai. Brijnath. At the same time this is happening, Brandt is telling the rest of the crew about the
The failed mission.
the couple that he was like a secret bodyguard detail for, failed to protect the wife in the situation, which turned out to be Julia, who is Ethan's wife. And I was just like, what? Like, that was one of the moments in this movie where I was like, I genuinely did not see that coming. Okay, cool. I like that he basically asked, like, yo, should I tell Ethan? And all of them are like, dude, I don't know. Like, I don't, maybe, probably not. I don't know, man. But they all go to Mumbai. This is where the whole team has like 15 different things that each one of them are doing in yet another giant heist. I like Paula Patton playing this reluctant sort of femme fatale in this scene of sort of like, I mean, I'm going to do it for the mission, but I kind of hate everything r regarding this. And she,
And
like,
she's had a crisis of confidence as well.
sure. And I also like that she can't help but continue to like sort of beat the guy up, the like media mogul rich guy.
Yes.
She like breaks one of his fingers. She slaps him a little bit. Like she plays a little bit hard to get, but also like, I really don't want to do this, so I'm going to take it out on you, which I think is really good. There's also a mission, the part where Brandt is going to dive into a chute, and Benji
And I
is going
catch
to
you.
catch him with magnets.
And I catch
Which,
you.
yeah, I'm gonna get you. I really like as Brandt is kind of hesitating to go jump down that chute. Even Tom Cruise is like, you need to jump right now. Like
Oh.
you need to do it right now.
And he's doing the stretches as well. Like he's doing the Goku stretches right before the jump.
It's
And it's just
really
like,
good.
okay.
It's really
Okay.
great. And actually, Jeremy Renner gets to do the shot in this movie, above a very sharp fan, which is actually pretty good. It's a pretty good shot.
Yeah, and I got you.
Yeah, I
But
got you.
still, that whole briefing in the plane, when he's like, "Yeah, you go down the fan, I catch you with these magnets, and then we go in," and then he's like, "Like the reaction Jeremy Renner has, where he's like, okay, but the part where I jump," and then and Benji's like, "And I catch you."
Right.
Besides, I've been more worried about the heat anyway.
Right.
And then there's that. What heat?
What are we? Yeah, I like that Benji's like, well, we're turning off the giant fan. Like, what do you think is gonna happen? Yeah, that whole thing is, it's kind of nice to see that even in that scene, Benji is kind of more seasoned for this stuff, where it's like, look, you just, if you're going to be part of this crew, just stop asking questions. Just jump down the chute. It will be handled. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. Everybody lives. Don't worry about it. They get the codes from the rich guy. God, a lot happens here. Gosh. Hendrix has already sent
He's
off the
using a public
broadcast
TV
codes.
station.
Right.
Yeah, he's using a public TV station to shut down the server so that they can't access it from where they are,
That's right.
but only he can access it. So they need the codes to get in, and they get foiled again. Hendrix beats them.
If every mission goes wrong, I kind of really like this idea. I like that there's like a little bit of technobabble here where Benji is like, they downloaded a virus from the satellite. And it's like, okay, that's sure, why not? I
And it
do.
turns out the whole infiltration was for nothing, including the sexy lady beating up the Indian media mogul, which is, it is hilarious how, like, when they finally get the green light, she's like, we are alone now, because every time she is about to start, somebody walks in. And he's like, yes, nobody's going to interrupt us here. And she just immediately choked them out.
It's great. I kind of like this scene with Renner that's
The
around
fan.
this. Yeah, where he's like escaping from the fan and he has to tuck like tuck and fold to kind of shoot all the way up and then kick off the wall to get. It seems it's like a very Ethan
Really
Hunt.
nice shot.
Yeah. It's like a real Ethan Hunt sort of scene where it's like I got to get out of here, so I'm just going to do the first thing I think of. There's a lot of stuff between like that shot and the automated car park that is all kind of mushed in my brain at this point.
Yeah, it's a countdown against the clock for the missiles to be launched, while at the same time driving through the place to get to the TV station. When they get to the TV station, he runs into the car park. He does come out and say "Peace on Earth," which is hilarious to me.
That's right.
Yeah. The electric Volkswagen, I think it is, or the electric. No, I think it was the electric BMW with the on case here.
Yeah.
With the heads up display and everything else going on.
Yeah.
And yeah, so they're at the TV station. The team is at the TV station trying to put the server there back together so they can broadcast.
Right, to stop the launch.
Yeah, so they can broadcast an abort code because the missiles are already away at this point.
Right.
And Ethan needs to go and get the case so he can send the abort code from the case, but that needs to be relayed by the TV station to get to the satellite to send the abort signal correctly.
Right. Otherwise, San Francisco will get bombed.
Yes. And in the meantime, we did see the submarine calling Russian high commands to get the approval, and it just intercepted straight away to that guy's like briefcase phone, whatever.
Yep. Yep. There's this kind of interesting automated car park scene where they're having a fight here. Hendrix just jumps off with the launch device. Is like, well, I mean, if you want it, it's going to be all the way down there with my dead body. Peace.
Yeah, you got like 2 minutes. Let's see how you handle this. And just straight jumps himself because they've been kicking the crap out of each other. Ethan's knee is shot. His arm is completely damaged beyond repair.
Yep.
Like, there's a lot going on. And I will admit, this is probably my least favorite climactic quote-unquote fight is the car park sequence.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, but motorbike ballet is better than this.
Yeah, I feel like this is probably a really great scene on paper that maybe just didn't get all the way there in shooting or editing or something. Like, it's a really cool idea, and I like the idea of them kind of like fighting through this thing and dealing with the car elevator thing that they're dealing with. But there's something about it that never came together for me. I agree with you. So then Ethan says, well, I guess I will just take a car and drive it off the edge and hope the airbag does its thing. Yay, it did.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to push the button and say a catchphrase.
Mission accomplished.
Mission accomplished. And it doesn't work. Just super good.
Because Benji, with his bleeding fingers, by the way, which is a nice touch, is trying to put the server rack back together.
Yep.
Renner can't turn the power on. Benji gets a kill. He actually shoots at somebody and hits them for once.
That's right.
Which is great.
Yeah, and Paula Patton also got shot at some point, so she's kind of having a rough time. They eventually get all the systems back online, and then Ethan manages to hit the button at the very last second, and then the disabled missile just doinks off the side of a building in San Francisco and just lands in the bay. Which is a pretty good shot. I like it kind of clip in that building.
Yeah, because the question is, if it would have clipped it beforehand,
right,
would that have been, you know, the end of it, shall we say?
Right, right. Were they just seconds off, really?
And that building is the Transamerica Pyramid, by the way.
It's a good name for it. The Russian agent who has followed them all the way across the globe went, yeah, you probably didn't cause the Kremlin bombing, I'm going to assume at this point. It's like, yeah, man.
Yeah, I love this. Like, you wanted me to follow you here, uh-huh, because we're on the same side. Why else would I believe this, right? So I guess we should be friends. Hospital? Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's just like, it's really good. So the to kind of round this out, the team meets back up in Seattle. Ethan is talking to Luther Stickle. Yay!
Yay!
Luther's back. And
I like the fact that they're literally making fun of him saying mission accomplished.
It's really good. It's that's a really good piece in this movie that I like, that Ethan is more than happy to even tell Luther about his failures for like a funny story, more than he's just like, I pushed the button at the last second, I was cool.
And I like said that mission accomplished. He's like, yeah. wait, you said mission accomplished.
It's so good.
And they're both just cracking up about it. It's so hilarious.
And I like that Ethan introduces the three agents and Luther's like, yeah, whatever, man. Peace. Like, he doesn't even really care about them at all.
No, I like the fact that he puts his hands in his pocket and Ethan's like, come on, man, I've got this. And he's like, yeah, I know you do. Flips him the bird and walks away. He's like, thanks to you guys, I got to spend a weekend at the bottom of the bay.
It's really good. Oh, man. This is where everybody agrees to kind of join the team with Ethan except for Brant. Brant decides to tell Ethan about his failure to protect Julia. Ethan actually decides to tell Brant at that point that, like, hey, you didn't see a body? Like, maybe I had a different plan, which turns out to be I faked her death so she could go live a life rather than be hiding out in the corners of the globe with me. So she got a new identity. He went to prison, sort of following the plan to get information for something else. And he also said, like, it was kind of a small price to pay for her to be able to live her life. So Brant goes, oh, you rascal. All right. I'll join the team. I'll pick up this iPhone.
We do see Julia as well in the,
yeah,
as she gets back and like goes into like a cafe with what looks like a work colleague for like after work drinks.
Yeah, so it's a cool spotted little scene.
I like the fact that she sees him.
Yeah, I do too.
Like, she sees him because assuming he went on the mission with her permission,
right?
Assuming they both knew that this was the end of the marriage kind of situation,
right?
But he wouldn't know if and when he would be back from the mission.
Right.
And even if he did come back, he wouldn't be able to be with her. So him seeing her and her seeing him is an acknowledgement of, I did it. The mission was successful.
Right.
I'm still alive.
We're both
so
okay.
We clearly still care about each other, but this is kind of the end.
Right.
Like, of the relationship. Like, it's a really nice little like 30-second sequence that says a
at
lot.
At most, yeah. Yeah. And then Ethan accepts his new mission and fades off into some smoke. And that's
he becomes a ghost, one might say.
That's right. He invokes his own ghost protocol. And that's the end of the movie. Just like three. I liked this one a lot. We haven't really talked too much about Brad Bird directing this, but I thought he did a really good job. I think I would hope that Brad Bird's influence on this movie might have been the sort of the more comedic lean that this one had.
I think it gets a bit of that from The Incredibles as well.
Mm-hmm.
But there is that. I know you. I'm trying to figure out the way to phrase this politely. It is missing that overarching sadness and tiredness that The Incredibles has, which is understandable as essentially a story told from the perspective of the parents.
Right.
It's missing that, which I think is both good and bad. I know you prefer to not have it there. I think it's a really nice touch in The Incredibles. I don't understand how this guy hasn't got more live action directing stuff.
Yeah, this movie is great. I think this movie is a lot of fun, and I think there's a lot of really great stuff in here. There's a lot of really great shots. I think this movie's like 2 hours and 15 minutes, and it kind of cooks the entire time. Like, I think
it feels like a 90-minute movie. Like, yeah. I watched it last night, I think it was. And I was like, oh yeah, this is going to be a long one. And I looked down, I was like, oh, it's almost finished. What?
It's got 20 minutes left. I don't really have anything negative to say about this. I think this one is all positives. I do like the a little bit of change of pace on this one, which is every single mission goes wrong. But it doesn't feel frustrating. It's sort of like they all went wrong because there's just too much going on, and at some point they're all disavowed anyway, so it's like that mission probably wasn't going to go well anyway because they have no tools at their disposal. But I kind of like that as opposed to I like seeing them win, but I kind of like seeing them hit a brick wall in most of this movie. And everybody's
I
great.
think
I'm a bummer because I'm worried Paula Patton won't show back up in these movies, and I wish she would. I don't know for sure, but
honestly, neither do I, because at this point I've officially hit my I've seen all of these movies. Which is interesting, to say the least. I think the biggest annoyance for me when it comes to this movie is I do like this movie a lot. A lot, a lot, a lot. I think it's a really good piece of cinema. I think the biggest issue it has is, and it's no offense to the dude, Michael Nyquist is not Philip Seymour Hoffman. The
Oh, for
villain
sure.
is okay to good,
Yeah.
but you can't beat Philip Seymour Hoffman. He's one of the best cinematic villains of all time.
And I think the thing that's interesting is the Ethan's group is always playing catch up to Hendrix. And Hendrix is just like doing his thing. He has this mission, he's working on it, he's got his goal. He doesn't really care about Ethan and his team. I think for most of the movie he doesn't even know he's there. Until like they meet in the tower. I think you're right. Like, I think they were kind of being hunted a little bit by Philip Seymour Hoffman, and this one is sort of like we're racing to stop this dude. Which is interesting.
Yeah, I like this movie a lot. It's definitely the funny thing is, like, I know a lot of people really like Mission Impossible 1. Like, this is my speed of movie. I like the action mixed with the spy stuff, not just the spy stuff. And one had some action in it, sure, but it was mostly tension building and stuff. It will always have the red light, green light helicopter explosion in the tunnel, which
Yeah,
is
you can't beat
incredible.
that. Rotten Tomatoes for this movie, tomato meter is 93%, which is, I think, the highest we've seen in this franchise so far.
Believe so,
Yeah,
yes.
that's way up there. And audience score is 76%. IMDb is 7.4 out of
7.4.
10. So that's, I feel like sevens and eights are pretty fair. I think I might like the movie a little bit more than that.
Yeah, for me, this is probably an 8 and 9s kind of conversation, if I'm honest.
I would agree, personally. I just think it's a great action movie, and I think there's a lot to like about it. I got no notes. Two thumbs up. I love
Really good movie.
Have Brad Bird do more live action, big budget things, because
Yes,
I don't really
I
think
did
he
look.
has.
He's done one more live action thing.
Okay, what's that?
Tomorrowland.
Ugh, buddy. Okay, well, whoops. Can't win them all. Let's give him another
Nope.
one then. All right. Well, that's it for Ghost Protocol. Thank you everyone for listening, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye. Little ghost emoji right here as we ghost you
That's
until
right.
next episode.